And Dr. Ranney, I want you to listen to a little bit from the president yesterday talking about the issue of personal protective equipment, mostly focusing on masks here. But this, again, we've discussed this many times. This is an urgent concern. You're in Rhode Island. You hear it from doctors all around the United States of America saying we are putting ourselves at risk, not just doctors, all healthcare workers, putting ourselves at risk treating patients because we can't protect ourselves. The president says there are a number of ways to make this better.
They're throwing away the mask right away. They're throwing away. And when you hear 55 million masks were ordered, I'm saying 55 million. How could it possibly be such a number? And I said, why aren't we sanitizing masks? You know, you look at the masks. I've looked at all the different masks. Some don't lend themselves to doing that, I think, but many do. And I said, why aren't we? We have very good liquids for doing this, sanitizing the masks. And that's something they're starting to do more and more.
Is that something they're starting to do more and more? And is that good advice from the president?
So I would love to invite President Trump to come tour my hospital with me and see what my coworkers are doing at the recommendation of the CDC. We are reusing procedural masks, N95s, and face shields for as long as we possibly can in order to preserve them. We are wiping down the face shields with bleach wipes, but it's really impossible to sterilize the N95s or the procedural masks at this point. There's no liquids that could do that without destroying the fabric and their protective ability. The CDC itself has told us to continue to reuse these as long as we possibly can. I'll note for the president that on an average shift in the emergency department, I see somewhere between 20 and 30 patients. If you multiply that by all the patients that come through my ED, all the patients that come through all the emergency departments across the country. Ideally, we would be going through millions of masks a day. That's the safe thing to do to protect us and our patients. Unfortunately, right now, we're not. We're reusing them. We're putting ourselves at risk as healthcare workers on the direction of the CDC. I really hope that we can soon see a federal system for distributing these masks and other supplies where they are most needed. The regional response is great. My governor has been great. My hospital has been great. Other states have done a good job, but we can't do it alone on a state-by-state basis. We really need a federal response here.
And I just want to show to both of you, I hope you can see it, I'm not sure of your technical capabilities in your studios, but the hospitalized coronavirus patients in the United States, 9%, 85 and older. In the 65 to 84 age range, 36%. You see 17%, 55 to 64. 38% if you add up 45 to 54 and 20 to 44. Dr. Shah, what are we learning as we go through this? About early on, it was, you know, it was older people are most vulnerable. Certainly, they're most vulnerable of getting seriously ill or worse. But what else are we learning about this virus and its spread?
Yeah, so what we're learning, John, is that young people are not immune. So this whole idea that this is, that young people are only going to have a mild flu-like thing and then they'll all be better. Many people will. But clearly what we're seeing is that some young people, people in their 20s and 30s and 40s, get incredibly sick. They end up in the ICU. They end up in a ventilator. They end up dying. And so this idea that this is only affecting a part of our population, I've always been skeptical of that. And I think the data now is very clear that it affects everybody. Of course, it affects older people more. But young people are not spared by this disease.
Ranney, jump in on that very point. You're in the emergency room every day. And as you jump in, I just want to show some pictures. We've all talked about social distancing. Just some pictures over the weekend here. People, you need to get outside. I get it. You need to get outside. But that is not safe. Those people are, that's in California. Those people are way too close together. This is here in Washington, down on the mall. Again, people need to get outside and breathe, but that is reckless. I'm sorry. I don't know another word for it. There's a little bit of spacing there in Central Park, at least as people try to exercise. Dr. Ranney, to the point that Dr. Shah was just making, what's different this week in terms of what you're seeing in the emergency room as opposed to several days or a week ago?
Yeah, so day by day, we're seeing increased number of patients with symptoms consistent with COVID-19. Young, old, they really, like Dr. Shah mentioned, span the full age spectrum. Unfortunately, we simply don't have tests. My entire state is running out of tests, and we are rationing them just as New York and California are. So I can't say what number of them have COVID-19. But my plea to my neighbors, my plea to my community, and the plea of my governor has been for people to stay at home, to maintain that social distancing. You know, school is out, but that's not a reason to go and have a sleepover or have a house party, right? That's just going to spread the virus. And then I see people coming into my ED with symptoms that I truly can't diagnose. I just have to guess. and then tell them to home quarantine and cross my fingers that they actually follow the instructions and stay home.